What are your core values? What will you be looking for in a girl? Will you just let your son go with a girl who has long hair and smells like shampoo? Or you add some other values? She should carry herself with some charisma. You see that Rebecca carried herself with some charisma. When she passed, they noticed her fairness, they noticed her beauty, went and got some water, and they noticed her. She should be able to handle interesting conversations, challenge some opinions, embrace some better ideas and new concepts. That is the kind of girl I want my son to consider. Hello everyone, welcome to Consistence Place channel. I am so happy to be back. Thank you for those of you who were checking on me while I was off. And today I am sharing with you what I would tell my son to do before he chooses a spouse in future. Marriage is the second most important decision you take in your life after you give your life to Christ. And unfortunately, so many Christian brothers marry for the same exact selfish reasons like unbeliever. They say they have this chemistry that make them want to be physical and can't wait to do biology. And after marriage, you will say, she is not the person I thought she was. This is because you ascribed strength to her that she did not have. And keep in mind that none of the above will predict future marital happiness. Sexual relationship in marriage breaks down because of character. And character is also what will sustain a good marital relationship. I will tell my son to make sure that he wants to make a happy and successful marriage relationship that honors God. I'll also tell him that there is no one formula to choosing a path, but the best way to do so is to remain steadfast in the will of God. And as you are serving God in his will down the line, along your path will intersect and you will meet a wife that is suitable for you. So the best thing to do is to remain in the will of God and seek ye first the kingdom of God and its righteousness, and all these other things will be added unto you. That is Matthew chapter 6 verse 33. And these are the points that I will tell my son to consider, take them into consideration before choosing his future spouse. Because my son once told me that he wants to get married to a girl who has long hair and smells like shampoo. And then now, because he told me that when he was very, very young, now he's growing up, so I'm considering these points to let him know before he chooses his wife, rather than only relying on long hair and shampoo perfume. Point number one, their commitment to God. Is the Holy Spirit active in their life? I'm not talking about people who go around speaking in fake tongues and making noise, blah, 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 here and there. But I'm talking about, are the fruits of the Spirit active in their life, according to Galatians 5 verse 22 to 23, that says, for the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, patience, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. This fruit needs to be active in their life. You want to marry a girl who is full of joy, who has patience, who is full of love, who has long-suffering, steadfast. You know them by their fruits, you shall know them, according to Matthew chapter 7 from verse 15 to 20. By their fruits, you shall know them. And do they value sexual purity? Do they keep their pleasure above Christian integrity? You have to check for all these things. And you also have to be careful with people who camouflage in the name of believers just because they want to get you in marriage. God is a dynamic God. God is not silent in somebody's life. When God is in somebody's life, that person professes the life of God with the fruits of the Spirit. When God is in somebody's life, the person is led by the word of God. All her actions are based on the word of God. And anything that she does, she backs it with the word of God. She doesn't just go around copying people and doing things because they see people do, but they base every decision they make in their life on the word of God. That is how you know that someone is committed to God and the Holy Spirit is active in their life. Point number two, commitment to others. Do they have a mentor, a parent that they are committed to? do they have a pastor or a spiritual authority that they are committed to, that they are submitted to, that they are accountable to? Because it is a red flag if you have a young girl who cannot live with anybody in their family, any mentor or any spiritual authority, because she claims that everybody is so controlling and she wants to be independent. And also that would be a red flag, because as soon as you marry her, you too will become too controlling for her. I'm not talking about you have to control her, but some people that just cannot tolerate people or mentorship, or they're not open to learn. If you read Ruth 3:16, you see that Ruth was very committed to Naomi. Everything she did, she gave an account to Naomi. She was submitted to Naomi. She respected Naomi. So that's what I am talking about. You also have to check her relationship with people. Is she constantly breaking up with people? Does she have loyal friendship? Does she keep loyal relationship? Does she keep people? Does she have that integrity? That's what I'm talking about. Do you have sons or do you have daughters? What will you tell them to consider before they choose a spouse of their life? Point number three. She has to be submissive. When I say submissive, you see in Ruth 3:16-20, Ruth was very submissive to Naomi. Everything she did, she voluntarily submitted herself, was subjected to Naomi's authority. You don't want to marry someone until you know that she has some spiritual coverage, she has some authority that she looks up to, that she can relate to in times of crisis. When there is a problem, she knows exactly who to talk with. You don't want to marry a girl that is not submitted to her pastor or to her spiritual authority, that just does what she likes in the church. Nope. Ephesians 6:3 says that honor your father and your mother and it shall be well with you. You know, if you want to marry a girl that it shall be well with you, let her carry these blessings with her. 1 Peter 5:5 also says, likewise, ye younger, submit yourself unto the elders. Point number four, she has to be supportive. How do you know she is supportive? You need someone who is supportive to their mentor or to their parents, as Ruth was supportive to Naomi. Because you need someone to support you during your times of challenges, during your times of crisis. You also need somebody to support your vision, support your mission, and also pursue her own alongside. That's the kind of person you need to marry. And to check that, you also have to see how supportive is she to her environment. Point number four, their ability to serve, be homely, and to nurture. They need to have the ability to render tender-hearted, compassionate care, because you are marrying the mother of your children and you need someone who can give proper attention to others and serve them selflessly. How are they involved in their church? How are they involved in their community? Or how do they meet the needs of others? Or are they so self-centered? Do they go out of their comfort zone to serve others, or they are just contented with the bare minimum? When you see the example of Rachel in the book of Genesis 29:9, you see that Rachel came with her father's sheep, for she kept them. She was involved in doing something in her father's house. Let you look at a girl in the house where she is living in. Are the things in that house prospering? When Joseph was in Egypt, in the house of Potiphar, Potiphar's business prospered. His home was prospering. Is she, where she lives, is there only wahala, 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 or there that home or that place is actually thriving because of her presence? Is she the kind of person that when she will leave, people will cry that she has left, they'll miss her, or she's the kind that they're praying that she should go quickly because they don't want her presence there? When you also see Genesis 24:17-22, you see that Rebecca, when she was tending to the people of Abraham, she actually nurtured them, she served them, and even went beyond expectation. That's the kind of qualities you should be looking in a woman. How does she serve her community? How far does she go to help others? Because that's the same attitude she will bring into your home. Point number six, how do they handle conflict? Conflict reveals what each person cares about and can be of great value if handled in a mature and godly way. Conflict is usually the test of time. It is what we tear that infatuation, that chemistry or electricity apart, and try your compatibility. Did you just say you were very compatible? Wait until you get into a conflict, and that will tell you whether it was just infatuation or love. When Joseph found out that Mary, his fiance, was pregnant, he did not broadcast her name. He dealt with the issue discreetly in order not to scandalize her name. Point number 7, their ability to share. How can I overemphasize this? Check out to see if they are givers or takers. Selfish people only give when they have something in return. They might just be giving to you because they want to get your hand in marriage. Check out how they give to others. Check out how they give to their families, their friends, their community, their church. This is because when you marry, you will have to share your life and everything, and marriage will not be fulfilled if there's no willingness to share. Point number 8. She should be humble. God resisted the proud and give grace to the humble. She should be humble enough to be available to learn, to grow, open to new opinions and new ideas. She should be humble enough to be able to humbly manage her career and family alongside in a very godly way. Some career women don't listen. They feel they have arrived and nobody has to talk to them. Beware of those kind of women. They should not also feel more important than you and think that you are the one benefiting off this relationship and she has actually nothing to get out of it. No. She also has to give you value and feel blessed having you, and be open that you both should grow together. This one is already in the case, maybe when you're already in courtship. Point number 9, she should have something to offer. Rebecca had her calabash and was offering water. Ruth had her service and was helping out in the farm. Rachel was helping out with her father's sheep. What does she have to offer? Don't just marry a girl who is just sitting there and waiting for someone to come and rescue them out of misery. Don't you see that Rebecca was just there doing her thing, going to the well, getting her water, and then they were just noticing her and she was just there doing the service. She never even knew that there was someone there who was checking her out. But you see, she would just carry herself around and do her thing. You have to look at someone who is already very content in what they are doing that aligns with your core value. Point number 10, she should take pride in her physical appearance. She should carry herself with some charisma. You see that Rebecca, if you read Genesis 24, you realize that Rebecca carried herself with some charisma. When she passed, they noticed her fairness. They noticed her beauty. She went and got some water and they noticed her. You also read Ruth 3:3, you realize that Naomi told Ruth, dress up, put on some perfume, and before you go meet Boaz, come on, girls. You know, you have to look for someone who takes pride, who takes care of their physical appearance, is pleasant in their style, you know what I mean? It's not a crime. This is something that you need to take into consideration. If you marry a dirty girl, know that that's what you buy. You need to marry someone who takes care of their physical appearance. And you don't have to limit that. You have to associate this with other characters. Point number 11, she should be a graceful person to be around. She should be a fun person to be around. She should offer companionship, friendship, make people laugh at funny things that people say around her. She should have this friendly and lively vibe surrounding her. If you read in the book of Colossians 4:6, it says, let your speech be always very graceful, seasoned with salt, that ye may know how you ought to answer every man. So you need someone that is very, very lively. I know my son. What does your son want? Point number 12. She should be dynamic and intelligent. She should be ambitious to grow. She should be able to handle interesting conversations, challenge some opinions, embrace some better ideas and new concepts. That is the kind of girl I want my son to consider. So these are the 12 points I will talk to my son about before he chooses his spouse. My son is still young, but I'm working on that. All right, was I too hard? Was I too rigid? Mothers, leave your comments down below. Young ladies, leave your comments down below. Was that too hard? But those are the things I want my son to consider before getting married. As a Christian woman, from my experience, from my observations, and from my research, this is what is in my mind that I will talk about to my son. And young men, what do you think about this point? If there's any point that you might want to add to this, let's hear what you think in the comments section. Thank you for watching this video. I really appreciate you watching. If you like this video, give it a thumbs up, share it to whoever you want to share with, and until then, see you in our next video. And don't forget to subscribe to this channel and put on the notification bell so that each time we put a new video, you are first to watch.